the host of College Football Smothered and Covered, wherever you get your podcasts. You can read him on OutKick as well, who was on hand on the sideline for that insane game, Georgia-Alabama in Tuscaloosa on Saturday night. Barrett, how are you? Appreciate you being here.
I'm good. I've recovered from Saturday night, which was, like you said, one of the wildest football games I've ever been to. I would say top three in terms of games I've attended. It was awesome. It was everything we love about this sport. And I mean, I can't imagine that game having anything more than what it did. It was great.
We were talking during the break. So you go, you know, you're going to be at the national championship game. You go to a select few games to actually be there and cover in person. What did you feel? Why did you feel this game was important to include on that list? Like, did it live up to your expectations? Did it go beyond them, beyond any expectation you could have possibly had for what amounts to a classic in the SEC?
No, I mean, I couldn't have scripted this. You know, I did think it was going to be a track meet, and it was in the second half. In the first half, not really, because Georgia just couldn't move the football, and Carson Beck was a hot mess. So, you know, I think when you see the schedule come out, you're like, okay, that's one you got to go to. And look, I think when all is said and done, that might not be the most important game of the season because those two teams probably are going to make the college football playoff anyway. But in terms of overall entertainment value, I can't imagine scripting anything like that because it kind of had everything, right? It had Alabama defensive domination and offensive domination. It had a star quarterback completely melt down. That quarterback get off the ground and look like a superstar. It had a total meltdown by the team that was winning. It had a total resurgence by the team that was getting its tail kicked in the first half. And then you had back and forth basketball style football at the end. I mean, it really had everything you could possibly imagine.
Best game you've seen in person since when?
Alabama-Georgia national title game. And that one might not even be above it. If I was going to go even further back, it would be the kick six, you know, just because, I mean, we don't need to explain why the kick six was better than that one, but it's top three for sure. I'd probably put it number two.
Did you leave feeling any differently about either team? What were your preconceived notions about Alabama and Georgia going in, and how did you leave?
I kind of felt the same way. I picked Alabama because Georgia can't run the football, and they didn't run the football. And I think that was a big reason why Carson Beck struggled, is that he did not get any help. And really, he hasn't gotten any help all year. And it goes back to something that I've said all offseason, that Trevor Etienne is not a number one back. He's a solid 1B if you have a 1A, which is a lot like Georgia operates that way, right? It was Gurley and Marshall. You know, it was Chubb and King. And then it was Chubb and Sony Michel. Like, that's how they operate. Zamir White and James Cook. But they don't have a number one. They don't have that alpha, and they have not shown that all season. Rushing wise, they're below average. So that was why I picked Alabama to win the game. Georgia's not a complete team. We've seen that all season long. And that's not to say they can't become that, because they've got weapons, and I think they've been beat up at running back, in fact. So they can still find a way to make it work, but wrong team, wrong time for the evolution of Georgia. So I honestly left basically content with because of what I thought going in. I was disappointed, though. The one thing that did shock me was Carson Beck being as rattled as he was. I think that was the first time we've ever seen some kinks in the armor for a guy who I think legitimately was in the Heisman Trophy race going in, and NFL scouts love him. And I think he lost a lot of money.
Well, and speaking of quarterbacks that NFL scouts love, that, you know, people that cover those quarterbacks in college have those questions about, it ties directly to the discussion we've had here, Barrett. We were just talking about it during the break. Will Levis obviously has had his struggles this season. Titans are sticking with him. They need to find out what they have in him. Anthony Richardson having his struggles in Indianapolis. Colts are going to stick with him when healthy. They got to find out what they have in him. But he steps away with an injury, and Joe Flacco gives them the most competent quarterback play they've had. As a guy that covers college football so closely, how do you kind of process seeing these players, these prospects that have all the tools, but had their struggles in college and raised those question marks in college, and then they get into the highest level of football that there is, and people expect them to perform early. Like, are you, I'm guessing you're not too surprised that Anthony Richardson and Will Levis have not taken the NFL by storm after what you saw in their college days.
Not surprised at all. You know, NFL scouts think they're the smartest people in every room, and they get stuck on things that matter to them and don't come off of it very easily. And I know a lot of NFL scouts, and I know a lot of draft analysts, and they want to do that. They want to prove that they're the smartest person in every single room. All you had to do to watch to determine Will Levis was going to be a bust was watch Will Levis. Like, that's all you had to do. I don't care what his measurables are. Doesn't matter to me. Watch how he operates. And it was pretty obvious. And Anthony Richardson, I mean, dude, you can't start for Dan Mullen. Like, you're the perfect fit for Dan. And you can't start for him until, you know, you get that 1 year where it's like, okay, maybe this is actually going to work. And of course it doesn't. Anthony Richardson is, I think, the poster child of NFL scouts not coming off of what they thought, the measurables, what they see at the combine. It's, look, is that the way it is every single year for every single quarterback? No. You can look at someone and see measurables and be like, that dude's going to be awesome, like Josh Allen. And then he actually comes through. But those instances to me are few and far between, because when you have guys who look the part but were never the part, you're running a big risk of maybe ego getting in the way of your front office. And I think in Will Levis's case, you know, and in Anthony Richardson's case, that's exactly what happened. And I'd say it's Malik Willis too. Like, that, look, you get kind of blinded by the shiny objects sometimes.
Barrett Sallee is our guest. At Barrett Sallee is where you can find him on Twitter. So I don't know how NFL scouts are feeling about Carson Beck right now after that performance against Alabama. The bad was bad, but the good was good, right? I feel like people are going to quickly forget that Georgia outscored Bama 34-13 down the stretch there. It has me wondering, who is the more dangerous team for Tennessee to play? Because I think there is this blanket opinion that, well, it's Alabama. They won the game. They were up 28-0. But I'm not ignoring the rally that Georgia made there, Barrett, that not many teams in the country could do in Tuscaloosa in front of that environment. So if you're putting yourself in the shoes of somebody in Knoxville and you look ahead at hosting Alabama in October and traveling to Athens in November, what seems like the more dangerous matchup to you?
Oh, the more dangerous matchup is 100% Alabama. They do everything. And there's nobody on Tennessee's roster that can cover Ryan Williams. There's nobody pretty much on any roster that can cover Ryan Williams. Jalen Milroe in this offense has clicked way faster than I thought he would, and in a much bigger way than I thought he would. So, you know, when you look at Georgia, you know, what's Tennessee's strength defensively? It's its front seven, right? Georgia can't run the football. So if Georgia can't run the football and you get Carson Beck in third and longs, we saw what happened against Alabama. That's not to say he can't get better, but from a matchup perspective, things don't really work in his favor when they're playing Tennessee. So Alabama's a much, much tougher opponent for Tennessee because it's a complete football team. Tennessee is too, but because Georgia can't run it, you know, you put Carson in a difficult situation. And like I said, Tennessee's defensive front really, in my mind, has been the driving force of Tennessee's resurgence right now.
I was fascinated at whichever fan base lost that game, Alabama, Georgia, how they would kind of handle it. And Georgia ends up on the losing side. We thought that Kirby had a Nick Saban problem. It felt like Saban was the only thing standing in the way of Kirby Smart and a Georgia dynasty over the last few years. Can we say that he just has an Alabama problem? Maybe not to the extent of a Ryan Day, Michigan type of problem, but does Kirby Smart have a legitimate Alabama problem?
No, I don't think so. You know, he doesn't care who's on the other sideline. You know, they have really good players. And I think that Kirby miscalculated in a couple of key areas, specifically running back. But also, I think that he thought it would be a lot easier or more easier than maybe it has been to replace Ladd McConkey and Brock Bowers. Oscar Delp really hasn't been anywhere close. Now they're saying he needs to be Brock Bowers, but he hasn't been close to where Brock had them from the tight end position. There's no Ladd McConkey on that team. There's no downfield threat. Arian Smith kind of, but you know, that's just it. I think that he thought that he could develop his players and not miss a beat. And sometimes that happens. You know, you miscalculate every once in a while. And I think that's what he did. You know, Alabama's hard to beat. Like, that's a really good team in terms of just overall roster talent. Now, it's not where it used to be under Saban, but when you got guys like Jalen Milroe and Ryan Williams and Caden Proctor and Xavier Brown, and, you know, these guys can play. These guys are ballers. So, you know, I just think that's all there is to it. You know, they might see each other again. And when that happens, I guarantee you Kirby will have a different game plan.
Tennessee playing Alabama on the third Saturday in October in a couple of weeks, Barrett. We've got someone in the YouTube chat. Ja'El says, rush forced by Milroe, man up the wide receiver, easy. That's it. That's all it takes to beat Alabama in Neyland Stadium on October 19th.
It's just that easy.
That's it.
It's just that easy.
But in all seriousness, Ryan Williams.
You know, it's really easy for me to grow back my receding hairline. All I got to do is get hair.
Just simply get hair. Yeah, exactly.
Just that it. It's just that simple.
Ryan Williams, though, I asked you Alabama, Georgia, best game since when. Ryan Williams, most impressive freshman at the college football level since who for you?
Oh, man. Most impressive freshman. I can't think. Jeremiah Oper at Ohio State is the same pretty much right now.
Yeah. But he's just 18, right? He's just a normal freshman age.
Yeah, they're the same guy. Like, let's just be honest. One's in the Big Ten, one's in the S. It's the same guy. Most impressive freshman. Johnny Manziel. Does that count?
Johnny Manziel has to count, right? I guess unless we're discounting redshirt freshmen, because then I guess you lump in Jameis Winston. But it really is about his age, right? Like, what he's doing was at the level of I don't know where that stacks up in single game wide receiver performances in Alabama history. Would have to go back and look at the numbers. But for him to be doing that type of thing that we saw Amari Cooper do and take over games and Julio Jones do, or the kids should be making a homecoming proposal. I don't know if we've ever seen anything like it. Like, he's going to be 17 at the end of the season. It's not one of those where he's 17, but he's going to turn 18 in a week. Like, he's going to be 17 after the season is all said and done. I don't know if I've ever seen anything like that. Brock Bowers comes to mind, right? 18 years old, leading Georgia.
You kind of knew what Brock was going to do.
Yeah. But it's just incredible. Did it dramatically alter what you thought about Alabama at all? Just understand, because that felt like a question going in, right? Who is really going to take the reins at the wide receiver position?
Yeah, I mean, that seeing what he was able to do early on, it changed. Because, that was one of the bigger questions going in for the Crimson Tide is who's going to step up? Because they really didn't have anybody. It was like one of those things where Ryan Williams better be that dude, because there's not a ton to love about that. So, you know, because he's been successful, obviously, you know, other guys have stepped up. They're taking advantage of one-on-ones, things like that. So that changed my opinion, but that was really early on, right? Even in the South Florida game, it was like, okay, other things are causing problems. That's not it, right? So, it made me change my opinion early. But, I mean, everyone kind of saw Ryan in high school. You kind of knew what he was going to be. I didn't think he'd... Like, I stood next to him. I could have stepped out three steps and tripped him on that touchdown. There's a picture of me on the sideline that you can see. It's on my X feed that I'm just... My jaw's on the floor. Like, there's no way a human is that fast and has that kind of body control. No way.
At Barrett Sallee is where you can go find it. Host of College Football Smothered and Covered. Wherever you get your podcasts, hear him on SiriusXM. Read him on OutKick. So, national championship contenders after Saturday. Assuming you still include Georgia in that list. Sure. And we'll keep it in the SEC for the moment. How did Saturday impact the way you view the hierarchy in the SEC right now? And where does Tennessee kind of fit in with the Alabamas and Georgias after last weekend?
Yeah, I mean, Tennessee, Texas, Alabama, put them in however order you want.
Same tier. Honestly,
you can make an argument for all three of those, and they'd be pretty good arguments, honestly. So put those together. Ole Miss is the one that I kind of looked at like, okay, did you believe your press clippings? Because they came out flat from the beginning. And that's not to take anything away from Kentucky, because, you know, I had Jake Crane from Crane & Company on my show, Smothered and Covered today, and we talked a little bit about, you know, how teams evolve. It's kind of like college basketball now with the transfer portal. You don't really know what you have until you know what you have. And Kentucky, I think, was misusing Brock Vandegrift against South Carolina and realized it and fixed it. And so you can't I don't think you should be able to just say, oh my God, Kentucky got upset by Ole Miss got upset by Kentucky. That's terrible. No, Kentucky's pretty darn good now. But the fact that they came out, that Ole Miss came out flat, kind of scares me. And I mean, with LSU, the defense is just not what it should be. And still with Georgia, I'd put them maybe at the back end of that first tier. Just again, because they have a weakness that they haven't solved yet.
That rat poison, Barrett. Lane Kiffin talks about it all the time. Might have come back to bite him.
Yeah.
Elsewhere, is it too early to say that the year two feelings at Auburn with Hugh Freeze are starting to feel a little similar to what the year two feelings were with Billy Napier in Florida?
Yeah, year two, yes. I think that's a fair comparison because it's really confusing for Auburn right now because Hugh got, ridiculed for saying, well, if they played Arkansas 9 times, they'd win. But I understand what he was saying. Yards per play wise, they were 6th in the nation going into that game last weekend. They actually moved the football really, really well, but the turnovers are part of their DNA too. But I understand what Hugh was saying. And for Auburn fans and boosters, I think they have to look at it. And I think they are looking at like, okay, a lot of the stuff that Hugh tried to address worked. The wide receivers are getting open. The offensive line's better. Peyton Thorne, when he's not turning the ball over, is actually finding those receivers. And yet it's still not working. So, it's one of the most unusual situations that I've seen in a long time because, again, the things Hugh is saying are true if you ignore the full picture. Because usually you can't avoid that if you're struggling, but Auburn can. So I think that's the biggest problem with you. And at some point, those boosters and those decision makers are going to be like, dude, we can't ignore the problems anymore because clearly it's a problem. Clearly, you're not doing your job and getting them prepared to create the paint the whole picture. Right now you just got a sketch and it looks kind of good. But you still got to paint it, right?
Well, I'm with you that the things he said are true, especially after the turnover-riddled Arkansas game. But if I'm an Auburn fan, Barrett, I'm tearing my hair at hearing Hugh Freeze say, we got to find someone that won't throw the ball to the other team, when that was the discussion around Auburn throughout the course of the offseason, the fact that they didn't go out and get a quarterback in the portal.
Well, yeah. I mean, he married himself to Peyton Thorne way too early. The thing about Peyton Thorne, though, and it's kind of like a microcosm of the season, he will make some really good throws. He will make some really, really good throws, but he will also make terrible decisions. And there's no in between, right? Like, there's no in between. And it kind of goes back to the original point. Like, it's frustrating because a lot of the problems were fixed, and Peyton will tease you a little bit. And because he threw 3 touchdowns last week, like, he looked good until the final 5 minutes of the game. So it's a very confusing time because there's a reason for a little bit of a hope at Auburn, but there's a reason to be very concerned at the same time within the same unit of the team. You don't really get that a lot.
Titans fans listening are shuddering as you say that, Barrett, because that's been the discussion here throughout the course of the season with Will Levis.
I don't doubt it.
Are Heisman voters going to let this be an awesome Heisman race the way it seems like it should be? Or are we going to have to go about this fully under the premise it's going to go to the best quarterback at the end when we've got Travis Hunter doing what he's doing and the Boise State running back? I mean, it feels like it's truly shaping up in an awesome way, but I don't know if I can even trust myself to commit to following an awesome Heisman race.
Well, I'm a Heisman voter and we don't vote right now. So I can't, I actually can tell you who I'd vote for. If it's November, I can't, they'll hunt me down and break down my doors and kill me. I'd vote for Travis Hunter right now. He's the best player in college football. But I mean, you can't do both the things that he does at that level and not be considered the most outstanding player in college football. Now, Jalen Milroe is fantastic. I would put him number 2. Genty is great. I would put him number 3. But I don't see how you can avoid giving it to Travis Hunter. Because I don't care what Colorado's record is. Like, I honestly don't. Because he's still elite. You take him off that team, they might not win a game. You take him away from one side of the ball or the other, it makes it the worst unit in the Big 12. I mean, his value is unparalleled. So, I think it'll be interesting. And it'll be interesting to me to see how the voting block kind of works out, because there are a lot of people who are best quarterback, best team. And it is that simple. And generally speaking, a lot of those people do not follow college football on a day in, day out basis. But all of them know Travis Hunter. So you might see him chip away a little bit at that group, which in my mind, you know, there are a lot too many people that have Heisman votes. Maybe I should be one of those that have them taken away. I think everyone's going to know Travis Hunter.
Going to be fun. Barrett Sallee, host of the College Football Smothered and Covered podcast. Wherever you get your podcasts, hear him on SiriusXM. Read him on OutKick as well. Barrett, thanks so much, man. Really appreciate the time.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
At Barrett Sallee on Twitter is where you can find him. Let's expand on some of that. SEC observations next on 104.5 The Zone.